chapter 15, beginning with verses 16. And it's a story that focuses on the crucifixion. Knowing this is Palm Sunday, Jesus made his way into the city of Jerusalem, knowing exactly where his destination was. It didn't happen by happenstance. It wasn't an accident of history. It was something that was planned before even the foundation of the entire world. Before the universe was spoken into existence, Jesus knew his destination would be the cross. And the victory that the people celebrated, they never imagined would be won there on that old Roman cross. They would have seen that as just another defeat. And the power of the cross would have been for them at that moment, at that time, during that holy week, would have been a sign of the power of tyranny, not a sign of the power of the love of God that it would become. Yet Jesus knew that that's where he would end up. But he knew it would also just be a pit stop along the way. The Gospels tell us over and over again that Jesus would die. Jesus told his own disciples over and over again that he would die, that he would be handed over into the hands of evil men and that he would die. And there's even that story where Peter's like, "No way, Jesus. No way. This cannot happen to you." And Jesus told him, "Get behind me, Satan, because you don't have your mind focused on the things of God. You've got your mind focused on human things." He knew that this is where he needed to go to save humanity, to win the victory that we needed. And he was not going to allow anything to deter him or get in his way. And that's where I want to pick up here. The focal of all the Gospels, the focal point, is the cross. Even Luke's story of Jesus, beginning with the birth story and the Matthew story and the birth of Jesus being laid in the manger, he was laid in the manger in the shadow of the cross, that deep, dark, dastardly shadow of the cross. But we know as we read that story and hear that story and even the story of his death on the cross on Good Friday, we know that that dark shadow was cast by the light of the resurrection. So we know that the resurrection was in view. And the resurrection is important, but the resurrection should never, ever eclipse the significance of what happened on the cross. The farther we move away from the cross, the farther we'll move away from the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ. Mark chapter 15, beginning with verse 16, it says, "And the soldiers led him away inside the palace," that is the governor's headquarters, "and they called together the whole battalion, and they clothed him in purple, in a purple cloak, and twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on him, and they began to salute him, 'Hail, King of the Jews!' And they were striking his head with a reed and spitting on him and kneeling down in homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put up his own clothes on him, and they led him out to crucify him. And they compelled a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. And they brought him to the place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his garments among them, casting lots for them to decide what each should take. And it was the third hour when they crucified him, and the inscription of the charge against him read, 'The King of the Jews.' And with him they crucified two robbers, one on his right and one on his left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, 'Aha! You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross. So also the chief priests with the scribes mocked him to one another, saying, He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe. Those who were crucified him with him also reviled him. And when the sixth hour had come, there was a darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? And some of the bystanders hearing it said, Behold, he is calling Elijah. And some ran and filled a sponge with sour wine and put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink, saying, Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down. And Jesus uttered a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in the way he breathed his last, in this way he breathed his last, said, Truly this man was the Son of God. There were also women looking on from a distance, among whom were Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James the younger, and Joseph and Salome. When he was in Galilee, they followed him and ministered to him. And there were also many other women who came up with him to Jerusalem. This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Father, we thank you for your holy word. Pray that you anoint the words of my mouth and all of our ears to hear today the truth that you would have us to hear, that we may see a greater glimpse of the victory you won on that old rugged cross that so despised and ashamed by the world. We thank you today, Lord, for your holy word and your Holy Spirit. Inspire all of us today, Lord, and encourage and strengthen us in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, why did Jesus have to die on a cross? There's a lot of different reasons. The beauty of the cross and what happened there is kind of like a diamond with many different sides and many different angles. And depending on the way you hold it, it'll reflect the glory and the beauty of that diamond in a certain way. So there's many different aspects to the death of Jesus Christ. But one of the most important things to keep in mind is that this was not an accident. This was not a happenstance. That the cross was planned from before the foundation of the world. The vision of Jesus Christ that the book of Revelation gives us is a lamb, a conquering lamb who was slain before the foundation of the world. This was planned before Jesus Christ ever set foot in this world. As God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit planned the universe, if you will, this was already in the works. So it happened to fulfill the deliberate plan and the deliberate foreknowledge of God, make no mistake. And it was prophesied in many different ways and alluded to and symbolized in many different ways all throughout the revelation of the Scriptures, that this would be the destiny of the Messiah. All of the sacrificial laws and all of the prophets who foretold the coming of the Messiah in some way alluded to this event that would happen. So he died in order to fulfill the Scriptures. He says over and over again in many different ways that he would die in order to fulfill the Scriptures, that the Scriptures might be fulfilled, that the Scriptures must be fulfilled. And he insisted and he told us and reminded us that not one jot or one tittle of the law, not even one little decorative horn on a Hebrew letter would be left undone. That's the respect, and that's the awe and the reverence that Jesus had for the holy word of God, knowing that he would be the ultimate fulfillment of it, and that it was all about him from the get-go. So number one, it was to fulfill the plan of God, the plan of God also revealed in the scriptures. It was also, make no mistake, a bloody sacrifice, an intentional and a bloody sacrifice. This is the thing that so often today, and for many, many years now, that's been downplayed, even in a lot of our hymns and the selection of hymns, and if the old hymns make it into the new hymn books, a lot of times the hymns that emphasize the blood of Jesus Christ and the sacrifice and the bloody sacrifice that it was. Sometimes those words will be changed, or if they're left in the hymnal, or if they're not changed and they're left in the hymnal, a lot of times preachers will not select those hymns, or they will skip over those verses intentionally so, because they don't want to highlight the significance of the blood, because it sounds too messy. It sounds too negative, maybe. It sounds too barbaric, but make no mistake about it, the salvation of sinful humanity was a nasty and a dirty and a bloody, messy job that Jesus Christ did for us. All of these Old Testament sacrifices, to really appreciate and to understand what happened. And we really understand the significance of sacrifice. We really do. We know, if we have any sense whatsoever, we know that sacrifice, if we're going to have a future, sacrifice in the present is in some way important, right? That we have to sacrifice certain things now so that we can enjoy other things later. We might sacrifice some time so we can spend more time studying. We may rather go and spend time having fun and playing ball, but we know that if we're going to get the degree that we need, that if we're going to get the education and the training that we need to sacrifice that and trade it for something else in order to enjoy benefits later on down the road, if you got any sense, you know. Right? We know about sacrifice. Sacrifice, we enjoy the benefits of even animal sacrifice. We just don't think about it in religious terms. But if we went out to eat at Cheddar's last night, there's a lot of sacrifice that took place for us to have that simple meal. The 16 of us that were at Cheddar's last night with a Sunday school class. I saw steaks and I saw chicken. We understand that something has to be sacrificed. The significance of sacrifice should never be downplayed. The cross of Christ was a sacrificial death. Peter reminds us that our redemption was not bought with corruptible things like silver and gold, but it was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. His precious blood. His precious. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. All of those Old Testament sacrifices, especially Passover, especially the Day of Atonement, but all of them help us to understand the significance of this sacrifice that Jesus Christ made on our behalf. We saw this in our study of the book of Revelation. Because of the blood of the Lamb, the people of God are spared from the wrath of God, just like the people of God in Egypt were spared from the wrath of God that was poured out on the Egyptians. Because of the blood of the Lamb that they sacrificed, that they smeared on the doorpost. Praise God today for the blood of the Lamb. Let us never underestimate. Let us never downplay. Let us never turn up our nose at the blood that Jesus Christ shed to save us for our sins. It was a sacrifice. But we have to remember here too who it was that was making this sacrifice. This sacrifice was an atoning sacrifice. This was an atonement. Now, one way to get our minds around the word atonement is just to break it down into its component parts. At atonement breaks down barriers that are thrown up between two parties, between two persons, if you will. We understand this too. We understand, we have ways of acknowledging these barriers among us, even amongst ourselves. We do things like, right? Or we'll sigh and eye roll, or we may even turn our back, give someone the cold shoulder. We know about these barriers that happen between people. If you've been married for a while, I know you know about it. It happens, does it not? And we know that something's got to be done, right? To break down those barriers. That if those barriers go up, you don't just go on about your merry way and ignore them and they take care of themselves, right? Something has to be done. An appeasement has to be made. Something has to happen. Right? It might involve chocolate. It might involve flowers. It might involve a special dinner. It might simply, hopefully this is where you'll start, is just a simple, I'm sorry, or I love you more than our disagreement, or whatever the case may be, but something has to happen for reconciliation to take place, for that fellowship to begin to flow again so that we can enjoy the beauty of that fellowship. It might not just be between husband and wife, it could be between friends, right? It can be between neighbors. It can get bad. Just watch the idea. You know, I told y'all last week I watch Lifetime sometimes. I hate to admit it, the Lifetime channel. It's a pretty good story sometimes. I got hooked on Days of Our Lives one year while I was priming tobacco. I'd be priming back in the morning and I would go to have lunch at my aunt's house and she'd have Days of Her Life. And they had some serial killer thing going on. I got hooked on that thing. And even when I looked at her house, I was trying to figure out what's keeping up with Days of Her Life. Anyway, don't think less of me, Dean, please. But just watch some of these channels on TV now, the ID channel. They got these things where the bad blood between neighbors and how bad it can get and how evil things can really get. Something's got to be done. Something drastic at times has to be done for this fellowship to be restored. That's what atonement is all about, to restore fellowship, to reconcile. But this wasn't just any atonement. This was for the sacrifice of Christ, this was a substitutionary atonement. This was, if you will, a penal substitutionary atonement. Christ received a penalty that he did not deserve. The penalty that we deserve, he received the punishment that we deserve so that we could receive his righteousness. And this is the thing that so often today, so many downplay or ignore, and if they don't ignore it and downplay it, they just outrightly scoff at it and criticize it and mock it. They mock it as, well, that sounds like divine child abuse to me. That sounds like, why, if God would punish his son so that we could enjoy the benefits and blessings that he deserved, and he would take our punishment, that sounds like cosmic child abuse. There's theologians, preachers that call it this. That it's divine child abuse. But again, who was this there hanging on this cross? Who was that? Was that just some random guy that God was picking on? Was this just some angel that God was picking on? Who was that really there hanging on that cross, bearing our sin and the shame that goes along with it and the punishment and the curse that goes along with it? That was God the Son in the flesh who willingly laid down his life and gladly laid down his life. No one took it from him. He laid it down voluntarily of his own volition, and he did it because he gladly and wonderfully wanted to bless us and to save us from our sins. And he had no qualms whatsoever with the agreement and the plan that the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit had worked out from before the foundation of the world. That was God himself taking upon himself our sins That substitutionary part is he takes our sins and the punishment that goes along with it. The wrath of God that goes along with it. The Father punished the Son on our behalf, for our sakes. And Jesus the Son gladly bore it and gladly accepted it for our sakes, for us and for our salvation. But this is something that people want to deny. They want to say, well, that makes no sense to me. And of course, if it doesn't make sense to our little, you see how little my head, my head's smaller than most people's. You see how little this is? And this, there's a little brain in here. And even my whole body is nothing but a speck of a speck of a speck of a speck compared to a lot of things, okay, in the whole universe. But because something doesn't make complete and perfect sense to me, it can't be true. But it does. It does make more sense. And the truth of the universe is not dependent on what makes sense to me. Thank God. Thank God. And it requires a tremendous amount of faith to accept this. This is something that the world, even since the days of Jesus himself, the world scoffed at. The Jews scoffed at it. The Greeks scoffed at it. The Gentiles scoffed at it and mocked it. And they've continued to do that up until now and even today, to scoff and mock at this substitutionary atonement that the Father punished the Son on our behalf, that we might be free. He died so that we might live. He paid the penalty and he paid the price that only we and we alone owed, but only he could pay for because of who he was. In Galatians chapter 3, it states this, really, this is probably one of the most clear statements, but also we sang it from Isaiah 53 today. But here in Galatians 3, Paul writes it this way. He says, "For all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse." All who rely on the works of the law are under a curse, for it is written, "Cursed be everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law and do them." Now it is evident that no one is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. But the law is not of faith, rather the one who does them shall live by them. Here's the problem with the law. The law in and of itself, the scriptures tell us, David wrote about it in Psalm 19, Paul restated in Romans 7, I think it's verse 12. The law is holy, the law is perfect, and the law is good. The problem is not with the law. The problem is with, guess who? Us. It's with sin. The problem is sin. The problem is the sin that keeps us from obeying the law of God and receiving the blessing from obedience. And the only way to receive full blessing is full and complete obedience to God's law. James reminds us that if you break one part, you've broken it all, because it all goes together. It all hangs together. It's not separate, random things. It all goes together. So the problem is not with the law. The problem is with sin in us. And because of sin in us, it keeps us from obeying and therefore receiving this obedience, receiving the blessing that comes from obedience. It brings a curse. Curse is the opposite of blessing. But here's the good news. Verse 13, even though we could not keep the law and therefore receive the blessing, it says, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law. How? By becoming a curse for us. He became a curse for us. He took upon himself our sins and the punishment that goes along with it, so that we could receive the blessing of his righteousness and his obedience. It's not about being fair. This is not really about fairness. This is about mercy. This is about love. This is about compassion. And this is the love of God shown for us in Jesus Christ. We've got to remember this. We've got to cling to this. That's that song. That old rugged cross. That old rugged cross. I keep trying to say something else. Hallelujah, we got to cling to that old rugged cross. And everything that it means, and even that which we can't quite get our minds around, by faith we need to cling to the old rugged cross, because that's where our souls are saved. That's where the victory is won. Jesus was crucified by the hand of sinners, no doubt. Jesus was crucified by the hand of sinners. There's no doubt about it. But he was also crucified according to the will of God. The cross of Christ symbolizes the hatred of humanity for God. Somebody said, God came into this world in Jesus Christ, and in humanity, in their hatred for God, tried to push him back out of this world, and they pushed him back out of this world, attempted to, on an old Roman cross. But that same cross that represents the hatred of sinners against God also represents, that same cross represents the love of God for sinners. He was crucified by the hand of sinners, but also according to the deliberate counsel and the foreknowledge of God the Father. Isaiah 53, it really comes down to this. When people begin to deny these things that are so clearly stated in the Scripture, a lot, they don't respect the Scripture, number one. They don't have a high view of Scripture. And number two, they don't know the seriousness of sin. They don't think sin is somehow a big deal. Even though the most horrible and the most egregious things are happening every single day, and a lot of it in the name of convenience, and a lot of it in the name of personal comfort and security. Because we don't appreciate that sin is not just the bad things that we do. I know I've got people that don't even want to talk about it. Well, that's negative. Let's talk about positive stuff. Let's talk about self-help guru stuff. But you know, there are evil, evil things every single day. And a lot of it's not because of active disobedience. It's because of indifference. It's because of people sitting on their hands. It's because people are lazy. It's because people don't want to be bothered. A great theologian said a long time ago that we tried to trade really standing up for what is right for peace and security, and now we don't have either. So sin is much more serious than most of humanity has ever really imagined. So one of the reasons we don't appreciate the sacrifice of Christ is we don't appreciate the seriousness of sin and how it cuts us off from God, how it cuts us off from each other, and how much evil it creates in the world. And another reason is people want to deny the wrath of God. See, the whole Word of God begins to unravel when we begin to deny these things. You know, it just all comes apart. You might as well just throw it away. Instead of pretending like we believe it, might as well just throw it away and go be a Buddhist or a Hindu or something. You might as well go do something else. A lot of people don't like this because they say, well, God would never punish anybody. The God I believe in is not like that. And I know it's a hard message to hear, and it's a hard message to preach, and it's not popular. But you really have to deny every single page of Scripture to deny that God is a God of justice. And we say, well, the New Testament makes it all better. God help us. We haven't paid attention to anything Jesus said if we think that. That's the seriousness of sin. That's the wrath of God. So when we begin to deny those things, we're going to begin to deny what really happened on the cross. And when we reject what happened on the cross, we're rejecting more than we think. We're not just objecting to something that we kind of find, you know, according to our own modern sensibilities, you know, offensive. We're rejecting the very means that God won the victory for our salvation and for our redemption. That precious blood. God the Son taking the wrath of God for us, becoming a curse so that we might be blessed, dying so that we might live, and paying a debt This is the other aspect of that little diamond, the beauty of it. It was a debt that we owed that we could not pay. Have you ever owed a debt? Do you owe a debt right now? I've got friends that have like tens of thousands, like $60,000, $70,000, $80,000 of student debt. Some of them before they went on to do a PhD. Some of them before they went on to become a doctor. And they graduated from college with tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt sometimes. And it's incredible. And I just paid off my last student loan last fall. Hallelujah. You know how good I felt? I felt good. There was one time a few years ago, Christy was like, I got a special dinner planned tonight. I got a big, big surprise for you tonight. This was a few years ago. And we had this dinner, and she pulled out a title to our Toyota Camry, our 2002 Toyota Camry, and said, it's paid for. And we were excited. And all we had was a Toyota Camry. It was about 150,000 miles at that point. And we got another 50 or 60 out of it before it got into a little accident and got totaled. All we had was an old car with an expiration date. It was going to end up in a junkyard somewhere. What debt did Christ pay for us? The salvation of our souls, the redemption of humanity, so that we could be redeemed from eternal hell, separated from God, separated from His goodness, separated from His grace, separated from His mercy. Can you imagine if we really get this and we really appreciate this and we really understand what it is that God has really done for us in Jesus Christ? Do you know what the, remember those knocks on the door on TV when the Publishers Clearing House shows up and those people see that they just won a huge amount of money? And it's just, we're just talking about money. We're just talking about stuff that you can buy that eventually is going to fade away. We're talking about corruptible things. And you know how excited people get and how thrilled people get, right? Jesus Christ paid the price that we could never ever pay in a million years, in a trillion years. Hallelujah, the victory that was won for us, the debt that was paid, the burden that was lifted, the burden of debt, the burden of sin, the burden of rebellion, the burden of the wrath of God that was lifted there on Calvary's cross. It was mercy that didn't triumph over justice. It was mercy that triumphed through justice. God is a God of mercy and of compassion, a God of love and steadfast love, eternal love. And His mercy and His love far outweigh His justice. His justice, as He's described in Exodus chapter 34, His justice just gets a few words. And His mercy and His compassion and His love, several sentences. But He is a God of justice, and He punished His Son so that we would not have to be punished. Hallelujah. Praise God for what He has done for us in His Son. And all of this together, taken together, not picked apart and pick what we like and leave what we don't like. When you start to do that, you're not believing the gospel, you're believing yourself. That St. Augustine said that many years ago. We've got to take it all. And all together, it has this beautiful picture for us and the beautiful, most beautiful expression of love that this world has ever seen. The greatest love this world has ever seen. The cross is an expression of God's love. An unfathomable love that's hard for us to really imagine and understand. I was watching this movie a few years ago called Mission to Mars. It had Gary Sinise in it. And, you know, they're on their way to Mars, and they're on the ship. And, of course, if we're going to have a good movie to watch, something has to go wrong, right? And everything's going wrong. There's things going wrong left and right. You get one thing fixed, and then there's another problem. And, man, we're hooked. We're excited because that makes a good movie. And eventually the ship is going haywire completely and it's getting ready to blow and they all have to abandon ship. So they abandon ship in their spacesuits and their jetpacks and they make their way to some satellite that's up there in space or some space station, if you will. and they're clinging onto the space station, hanging on for dear life. And something happens where there's a married couple that was on this mission together, and the husband of this married couple slips and falls, and he is floating off into space, and his wife is trying to get to him, trying to help him, to retrieve him, and he knows that he's already gone too far, and there's not enough fuel in her jetpack. And they're a loving couple. The movie portrays them as a couple that was just very loving and close, and just had a tremendous love for each other. And the husband's floating away, and he knows that if he continues, his wife is going to be tempted to try to come after him, even though he's telling her over and over again, don't come, don't stay. I mean, don't come, just stay right there. Everything's going to be okay. Eventually, he realizes that the only way to keep her put is for him to pull the plug and to go ahead and die. And he dies so that she may live. And he dies out of love for her, knowing that that love has been abundantly returned throughout their marriage to him. That's a beautiful picture. That's a sacrifice that we can appreciate, right? The sacrifice of Christ is even greater, because Christ did not die for the godly. Christ did not just die for those who loved him and those who cherished him, those who blessed him, those who tried to express their love and adoration for him. He died for those who spit in his face, for those who mocked him and ridiculed him, for those who called him every name in the book but the Son of God, for those who cast stones at him and hit him with reeds and sticks, for those who turned their backs on him, and for those who abandoned him, for those who bit their tongues instead of professing faith in him, those who denied him like his disciple Peter. That's who Christ died for. And there's no greater love than that. Scarcely, Paul says in Romans 5, scarcely would one die for even a righteous person, much less for unrighteous, ungodly, unthankful people. Scarcely would any die. But Christ proves his love for us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us to redeem us and to save us. Not because he had to. Not because he was required to. Because he chose to, because he decided to, because he wanted to. Praise God for the example of Jesus Christ. Last week we saw the example of Christ in loving service, washing his disciples' feet, which reveals the very heart and the very character of God himself. And today we see the sacrificial giving of God the Son. Not because he had to, but because he wanted to. Because of his great love for you and for me. Praise God. Christ is our example. But he can't be our example before he is our Savior. And when he is our Savior, then he can be our example. And we know John 3:16. Can y'all quote it with me today? We can paraphrase if we need to, mumble it if you can. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hallelujah. Praise God. We also need to remember, as our example, we need to remember 1 John 3:16. You know John 3:16. 1 John 3:16, by this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. That's Christ, our example. Sacrificial giving and sacrificial love. Thanks be to God for his unspeakable, ineffable gift and sacrifice for us. Father, we thank you today for your love. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your grace. May we never, ever take even one jot or tittle of it for granted. We thank you that you fulfilled all of the promises of God. We thank you, Lord, that you died for our sins and paid the price and the penalty that we deserve. We thank you, Lord, for taking that punishment and for revealing our sin in rejection of you on that cross. But also in that same space, in that same place, revealing the love of God, the amazing love of God who gave it all for us. May we give it all for him and for each other. In Jesus' name, amen.